Public Affairs Broadcasting.
Special programming from Rockingham County Radio, rcrlive.com.
Hi, my name is Cindy Corcoran. I am the Assistant Superintendent of Instructional Support Services for Rockingham County Schools, and I also supervise our Exceptional Children's Programs. And with me today, I have some folks from the Instructional Support Services Department, and I'd like to introduce them to you now. To my immediate right is Ms. Tammy Barker. She is our lead school nurse. And my far right is Ms. Susan Long, and she is our lead social worker. So today we're going to be talking about the services that our school social workers and nurses provide. And waiting in the wings, that'll be talking with you a little bit after the break, is Dr. Kimberly Money, who is our district coordinator for our Gear Up program. And she's going to bring you some information about our Gear Up grant and the schools that that Gear Up grant focuses on. I did want to talk to our audience just a little bit today and remind you of something that's happening. It's a big event in Rockingham County. For our school system, this Friday we will be hosting our spring games for Special Olympics. It will be at Reedsville High School, not Rockingham High School. We normally have it there, but this year we're changing our venue, and it will be at Reedsville High School. It will be starting around 9 o'clock that morning. So I would love for anyone who's interested in seeing what the spring games look like, and also if you're interested in volunteering. We still need individuals who will volunteer for things and events, so if you're interested, please call Rockingham County's office and we'll talk with you about, you know, volunteering. But please come out and enjoy the spring games with us. It's a great time for our special athletes to really show their athleticism and for them to be recognized. But now let's turn our attention a little bit to what our school nurses do. So I'm going to let Ms. Barker talk with you a little bit about what special services these wonderful ladies provide.
Thank you, Dr. Corcoran. The North Carolina Board of Education requires that each local school system in North Carolina have a registered nurse available for assessment, care planning, and to evaluate students who have special needs. Because basically, every student or every child in our state can come to school, no matter what their disability, no matter what their medical need. And so our school has to be available to serve all students. Our school system employs 9 registered nurses, 8 of which are nationally certified, so we're very proud of that. Our recent nurse that was just hired is working on her certification, and we serve all 25 of our schools in the district. Each nurse covers about 2 to 3 schools, and they visit that school periodically during the week. School nursing is very complex, and I think a lot of people sometimes think that when you hear about a school nurse, they think, oh, it's just putting on Band-Aids and first aid. But it's a little bit more complex than that. And today I would like to cover a couple of things about school nursing. Most importantly, I think our school nurses help our children learn, and that's what being a school nurse is about. We remove the health-related barriers to learning. And through that, our school nurses are educated to address a wide range of health concerns that our students may have that may impact them and interfere with learning. That may be something as simple as a student comes to us with a stomachache.
Right.
And then we determine that they are taking medication at home and that probably they're taking it on an empty stomach. Mm-hmm. So it may be something as simple as calling a parent, working with that parent to ensure that that student eat prior to taking their medicine and coming to school. But yet, it can be much more complex in working with students and families who are students that may have diabetes, asthma, seizure disorders, severe allergies, require tube feedings at school. We have students who require catheterizations at school. And then we also have students who have behavioral health issues mm-hmm. that we work with as well. So we take those students, we work with those families to develop healthcare plans so that we can have a plan in place to how to manage that student appropriately at school. We also provide health-related services related to prevention and treatment of illnesses so that they can be healthy and stay in school. we spend a great deal of time assessing acutely ill students. For instance, if we're in the school and the student is not feeling well, our teachers will send students to us for us to evaluate so that we can determine whether or not that student can stay at school or whether or not that student needs to go home. In the 2014-2015 school year, we kind of did a study of our nurses and our students that we assessed, and we found that 80% of the students that the nurses assessed when they were in the school that day went back to class rather than checking out or going home.
And that's really your goal, right?
Right.
Absolutely is to make sure that the students who may be presenting something when they're not feeling well, but may be able to push through for the rest of the day and have that attendance so that they're in class.
Absolutely. And sometimes they don't think that, and so we have to talk to them and help them understand that what I call is that we all have partly cloudy days and bright sunshiny days, and so I try to help them determine, okay, this is a partly cloudy day, you maybe can push through, you don't feel your best, but I think you're okay. You don't have anything that's contagious, you're not running a fever, and I think you're okay. And so then we might give the parent a call, just let the parent know what the child is experiencing, and I try not to, and I think we're community advocates, and I think we're good for our community because the fact that we really try not to call parents to get off work to come pick up students unless it's absolutely necessary. We try to keep parents employed because we know that's very important economically. Our school nurses also identify vision and other health issues that impede school performance. For instance, we do vision screening on all of our students in grades K through 5 and in grade 8. And if we identify students that are having vision difficulties, then we make a referral to our local eye professional. We may have to help the family find financial resources for that eye exam. And it also may require us convincing a student that their vision is a concern or a problem. And what I try to tell our students many times is they don't like to wear their glasses, but I try to help them understand that if you miss a math problem simply because you can't see, it's not a true assessment of what you know.
Right.
So we try to make sure and help our students understand the reasoning for our job and for our referrals. But then again, we also may refer students for dental health. If they have a need, if they have a toothache, then we may have to help them find a dentist. And or it may be something is in that assessment, they come to us with a strep throat or a sore throat, and we assess that we feel like they probably do need to go to the doctor and have a strep test or something. So we try to make appropriate referrals as needed. Our school nurses make a difference in student health. We promote wellness. Several of our nurses participated in our Go Far after school clubs this year and ran in the recent Go Far 5K run that happened in our district. They also work with disease prevention, and they teach proper hand washing, and they respond to communicable disease outbreaks. And here in the western part of the county, as we all know, a couple of weeks ago, we had a GI bug outbreak at Huntsville Elementary. And who was the person there to identify the problem? Our school nurse happened to be at Huntsville that afternoon and recognized that there was an abnormally large number of students who were experiencing symptoms and notified me. And at that point, we were able to notify the health department. So we're really on the front line there to hopefully prevent further spread of illness as well. We really are the frontline safety net for our most vulnerable students. We feel that we're there advocating for them. And if we find students who have a problem, we want to help meet that need. We serve on our school's multidisciplinary committee. So for instance, if we have a student who's struggling, the teacher may bring that to a specific committee and the nurses are a part of that team to help find solutions and to help that student be a little more successful in their school setting. So it's a wide variety of things. In our school nurses, we feel like we're good for our schools because we feel like we allow our teachers to teach and our principals to do what they're best at and our clerical staff to take care of those needs within the school. One recent study, and I'll have to look here on my notes, by the National Association of School Nursing found that having a school nurse in a school saves a principal an hour a day, it saves a teacher 20 minutes a day, and it saves clerical staff 45 minutes a day. And I would really think that that's true in Rockingham County, because when we're not in our schools, we have to train clerical staff, teacher assistants, even teachers, some principals to administer medication, and to do procedures for students in our absence. So we do feel that having nursing schools does save time and is good for the school so that principals and everyone can take care of teaching students and educating students.
Well, and as a former principal, I know the value of our school nurses and what they do on a daily basis. And I have to say, I applaud our nurses.
I'm so
thankful that they are in our schools. And I know that our community feels as though our schools are safer and they feel better about sending their students to school when they know that there's a very highly qualified and skilled nurse on hand. We are just very blessed to have these nine individuals that are working with our schools. And we also have with us today Susan Long, who is our school lead social worker. And what she's going to tell you is that we have wonderful social workers as well. And they do a fabulous job for our schools, an excellent job. And so I'm going to let her tell you a little bit about what our school social workers do.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Susan Long, and I serve Rockingham Middle School, Rockingham High School, and Wentworth Elementary. We currently have seven social workers. Beth Berry serves the western part of the county. Stacy Cholula serves the Reidsville area. And Doug Corum serves the Eden Elementary area. And Tiffany Coker serves the Eden Middle School and High School, and Huntsville Elementary as well. Leslie Jenkins serves our alternative school, New Vision, Lincoln, and Mall Street. And Christy Orr serves Bethany Central, Monroe, and the Early College. And we're lucky that we work with the school nurses. We do have situations that require the school nurse and I to and the other social workers to work with each other, with families and students when medical needs prevent them from attending school. We have homebound services where the school nurse and the school social worker provide help for the family and serving as the liaison between the school to make sure that the academic piece is being addressed and we get them the services that they need.
As school social workers, we serve in a variety of capacities, but one of our biggest focuses is attendance. We address issues as well with assistance for families, with providing school supplies, clothing, utility, housing concerns.
Really just breaking down those barriers, correct? Trying to make sure that there are some things, that anything that we can do as a school system that's within our ability to do, that we are working towards helping that family make sure their students are in school.
Absolutely, because a child can't come to school and focus on learning when their basic needs are not being met or they have a medical condition that, you know, they need assistance with. As well as, like what Tammy Barker was saying about the school nurses, we also can help provide assistance if they need, like, help with getting dental or eyeglasses.
You work with local businesses and local doctors and dentists and that sort of thing to look at that.
It's transportation could be an obstacle, and getting those services set up and helping the parents walk through the appointment process and what has to happen in order for them to be able to get the need they need.
Can you tell the audience just a little bit quickly, because I think we're getting ready to take a break, can you tell the audience a little bit about the mediation process and how that works?
Rockingham County Schools works with redirections to address attendance concerns. Once a student has 10 unexcused absences, they're in violation of the attendance law. And that is at the point where it could go through the court process.
Mm-hmm.
Rockingham County is lucky enough to have redirections where we have the mediation meeting. We are able to schedule that meeting anywhere between 6 unexcused and 10 unexcused. Hopefully we try to get it sooner where they're not in violation of the attendance law yet. Mm-hmm. So we have that meeting with the family and the student and the mediator and the school social worker to talk about what is preventing the child from attending school.
That's not a we're here to blame you situation at all, is it? That's more of how can we help remove whatever is happening to get that student in school.
It's at a neutral site. It's not at the school because we can talk about things that they are experiencing at school. And if they're having any problems, then we hope that it's an atmosphere that they feel safe and to kind of share in their concern with.
Well, we thank both of these ladies for being with us. We're going to take just a short break and we'll be right back.
WLOE Eden.
WMYN Mandan.
Listen online all the time.
RockinghamCountyRadio.com.
Hi, and we are back. My name is Cindy Corcoran. I am the Assistant Superintendent of Instructional Support Services. And we've been talking with our lead nurse and our lead social worker. They've left now, and we now have with us today Dr. Kimberly Money. And Dr. Money is our district's coordinator for our Gear Up program in 6 of our schools. So I'm going to turn it over to her and let her tell you a little bit about this grant and what it does for Rockingham County.
Good morning. My name is Kimberly Money, and I work with the Gear Up program as coordinator here in Rockingham County. I work together with two other coordinators at the school level, Damian Price, who serves the Western area, and Ms. Ranganu Nayajeka, who serves the Reidsville area. We work together to serve these 6 schools, counting the Eden Zone, and we serve middle and high schools, students grade 7 through high school, and we offer a myriad of services to help support students that include both academic support and college access programming. We are one of 11 districts in North Carolina to be receiving this grant, and it's a 7-year grant, and we are currently in year 4 of the grant. Our overarching goals that come from federal government and run through the state are, the first one is to increase academic performance and preparation for students exploring post-secondary education. The second one is to increase the rate of high school graduation and participation in post-secondary education. And then our third goal is to increase Gear Up students and their families' knowledge of post-secondary options and financial aid planning. So in short, we just want to increase and significantly increase the amount of students that are attending college here and that understand that college is an option regardless of any socioeconomic barriers or other barriers that may exist for them.
And Dr. Money, just real quickly, can you tell the listening audience and our audience, our viewing audience as well, a little bit about what grade levels those particularly, and maybe how that's mm-hmm. impacted our middle schools, particularly the sort of the knowledge base of our, say, 7th and 8th graders mm-hmm. in terms of looking at now at the possibility of going to college and seeing that as something that can really happen for them.
Mm-hmm. Specifically for our 7th and 8th grade students, we have provided many opportunities for them to just become knowledgeable about what it feels like to be a college student. They have received opportunities to attend colleges locally in the area. We have had many guest speakers to come in also and to share knowledge, just basic admissions type counseling and knowledge about what types of courses in high school they will need to be prepared for their first year of college. And then many of our services prepare middle school specifically for high school and then ultimately for college through our tutoring program, for example, academic preparation. And so they obtain a much greater knowledge of what options are out there uh-huh. for them in
Absolutely.
High school as they
Absolutely.
Prepare.
And can you tell them a little bit about maybe college pairing? Like, for example, if a student were very interested in engineering, what might that look like if they were, mm-hmm. and you were talking with them about where those schools were that maybe would fit their needs?
Right. So we work closely with students, both in small groups, and we partner a lot with our other student support staff, like our counselors, to work with students on College Match specifically. We do this through our College Foundation of North Carolina, cfnc.org site, that offers lots of career-type inventories for students. And we try to really help students search, you know, their own talents, their own interests. And if we come across a group of students that specifically have an interest in engineering, for example, a lot of times we'll try to make it possible for them to go to North Carolina A&T or NC State or one of our local colleges that specializes in that specific area. This year, too, we've taken many students to the School of the Arts mm-hmm. to try to really, you know, connect with their talents and abilities and their interests, because we know when we do that, usually students will pursue and persevere to make sure that they're continuing to pursue their interests.
Well, who is our target audience when it comes to our Gear Up grant? Who do we really look and seek out to serve?
Right. Specifically, schools qualify for the Gear Up grant who also meet the 50% for free and reduced lunch. So students that are first-generation students are our main target. Minority students are students that specifically have a barrier that may prevent them from attending college or just obtaining the awareness that they need to know what they need to do to become a college student. So we really try to focus on those specific students, but any student in grade 7, 8 through high school for this coming, 8th grade through high school for this coming school year in year 5 can receive services through our Gear Up grant.
Well, you mentioned tutoring and you mentioned mentoring. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. Tutoring is one of our strongest programs through Gear Up. We offer tutoring at all of our sites. English as a second language and mathematics are our primary areas. Our high schools are also able to offer tutoring in some of our other contents as well. Depending on our school sites and just what our leadership teams feel is most appropriate for that school, we offer certified teachers that go into the classrooms through our push-in models, and then also we pull students out of the classroom sometimes in small groups, just to offer them that extra academic intervention and support that they need to be ready not only to succeed in their classes, but to prepare them for the next step in their education. We also, at the high school level, offer after-school tutoring as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then our mentoring programs, this comes through our Gear Up coordinators. We work with mentors. Sometimes we have near-peer mentoring groups, which is a student group like in a high school setting, mentoring a middle school student. We also both formally and informally mentor students in small groups with our coordinators.
It sounds like an exciting program, and it sounds like it's a benefit to our schools. I know working with Dr. Money, I am very impressed by the energy and the excitement around our Gear Up programs, and the students seem to be very much embracing that mm-hmm. whole notion. Mm-hmm. Now, we just recently had a financial literacy event. Can you tell the audience a little bit about that and where that took place and maybe who you coordinated with?
Yes. This was a great event we had in January. This was hosted by Rockingham Community College, and this was our second annual event. And it was called Show Me the Money, and it was a financial aid night where we partnered with the College Foundation of North Carolina. And our representative here is Ms. Tequila Hall. She came and spoke to all of our schools and parents, both elementary and high schools, were invited, and we had a nice turnout. Ms. Hall was our primary speaker, who shared just basic financial literacy information, and then we had special speakers from RCC in admissions, and then we had our College Advising Corps and Gear Up also speak and share about the individual supports that students receive at the school level, such as filling out their FAFSA, you know, as we all work together in student support services to work with students on their FAFSA, financial aid planning, and college advising.
Mm-hmm. We have a big event coming up soon, mm-hmm. don't we? We actually have something happening next week, as a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. Maybe we could talk a little bit about that.
On May 6th, which is next Friday, we have our Decision Day event. This is a day where we specifically invite our seniors at our high schools, all of our high schools in Rockingham County, to come to RCC. It'll be from 12 o'clock to 2 there in the Student Center, and we'll be offering lunch for those students, and it'll just be a time for us to both celebrate their decision to have made a decision for college, and also to provide a service to those students. We're going to be having a special guest speaker from a university come and share just guidance and words of wisdom for these students as they enter their first year of college. And we also have a panel of students that I'm particularly excited about. I feel like they're going to be able to share some firsthand experiences with our students and just some testimonials and words of wisdom as well about what to expect as a first-year college student and what they wish they had known as they were beginning, you know, a year ago at this time as a first-year college student. So we're very excited about that, and that'll be next Friday at RCC from 12 to 2.
Now, the Gear Up grant also provides some funding for professional development. It allows some professional development for our principals, even our assistant superintendents and superintendent. It provides professional development for teachers and even beginning teachers. Perhaps the audience might want to hear a little bit about what professional development those individuals and some of the individuals in our county have participated in.
Yes.
And what that entails.
This year specifically, we were able to partner at the state level with NCPAPA, the North Carolina Association for Principals and Assistant Principals. And we offer several different opportunities through the DLP program for principals to attend six different sessions at the state level supported through NCPAPA. Gear Up is one of those partners and funders for that. And so we have assistant principals and principals that have that opportunity to go and attend. We also offer other PD opportunities for our district leaders at the central office. And then our new teacher support program. Gear Up is partnering both this year and next year with our new teacher support to support beginning teachers through year three of their BT program. So they receive three different sessions at the state level they're able to go and participate in. And then we have local instructional coaches from universities, and UNCG is our regional support university for the new teacher support program. We have coaches from UNCG coming out, pushing into these classrooms and supporting our beginning teachers.
And I know that we have really participated a lot in beginning teacher training this year. We have a brand new beginning teacher coordinator, Angela Martin, and she's been working with several different departments within central office to really support our beginning teachers. And from what all I've gathered and the feedback that I have received, it sounds like this has been a really positive experience for our beginning teachers. And certainly for Rockingham County, we're always interested in supporting our beginning teachers. The Gear Up program has really boosted and given a lot more resources to our district through the funding that they have been able to support. Tell me a little bit about some of the trips that some of our students have been able to go to. Let's let the audience know like what colleges some of our students have been able to visit.
Well, this year our students have had the opportunity to visit UNC Chapel Hill, North Carolina A&T, Winston-Salem State, the School of the Arts, Duke University, Catawba College, Elon University, and Appalachian State University. And we've visited a few of those more than one time. So students have had that wonderful opportunity just to feel and understand what it's like to be a college student firsthand.
Absolutely. And I think one of the things I'd like to say to our audience before we wrap up, because I'm looking at our clock and we're just about ready to finish, but I would say that if you're a parent out there listening or a student out there listening, we're always working towards the goal of our students graduating and having post-secondary opportunities, whatever those opportunities may be. The purpose of the Gear Up program, though, is to really create that awareness and to create those opportunities for access.
Yes,
so absolutely. That our students really can see that there is an opportunity for them to go to college if they are so inclined to do so. And that those are there are resources and individuals such as Dr. Money and the other two individuals that work with you, that they are out there and willing to work with our students. Well, it looks like we're out of time, but we'd like to say thank you for allowing us to be on your show today. Have a good rest of the day.